throw my phone at you.
I'm about to get in a lot of trouble if you just keep calling her Jennifer Love Hewitt, dude. Like, the internet's going to be angry. By the way, welcome to this week's installment. We just finished up watching the first trailer from Alita Battle Angel that premiered last year and had me at hello. I'm so pumped for this movie. This is your boy Teach. I got a couple guests with me.
We are Daz and we are back and better than ever.
What's going on, guys? It's Fame from Don't Make Me Famous. And
can't believe we're famous.
Every time. I gotta catch him when he does this every time.
We're gonna get there. But with Alita Battle Angel, I'm pumped to talk about it because this looks like it's gonna be one of the very first live action anime translations that's geared for a success. Right? Nobody's mad at the crew. Nobody's mad at the cast.
This is one series I can honestly say from, like, the manga readers that I know. Shout out to Black Manga Critic, by the way, who put me onto the series originally. But I have only heard good things about the series as a whole and about the movie. So it's been pretty balanced on both sides of the spectrum.
So are we able to talk about this series or this show or whatever it is? Are we able to talk about this and not spoil anything? Because I don't know anything about Alita.
No, there's really nothing to spoil as far as the information that I have up to this point, because I only watched the OVA about an hour and a half ago.
So. Y'all, we do our homework, right? I was like a week ago, I was like, hey, do you guys want to do a hype video for Alita? Because I'm super pumped for it. They're like, yeah, sure. I gave them homework a week ago. It was
nice.
Homework
I got.
Yeah, but I'm used to it. The thing about it is that I'm actually kind of intentionally going in blind. I saw this, knew that it was a manga. It was a manga that had a 5-year run from 1990 to 1995.
Classic era.
Very popular, and the animation in the OVA is very similar to some of our favorites, Gundam Wing, and that era.
It looks like vintage Sunrise Studios, definitely.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. So it's a beautiful OVA, one that I'm definitely going to watch, but I think I'm going to give this movie a watch first.
Okay.
I'm going to wait till next Friday, February 14th, just to give it all its dues so that we don't get in legal trouble for saying its name so many times. February 14th, go see it in theaters, don't stream it. I have a thing against that.
We talked about this.
Yeah, we did. We're going to... Every time.
We talked about this.
You hurting the boom mic. All right, so the... I want editor's note. Greg, you got to get a graphic of Fame's... like an emoji, a bitmoji of him just holding a boom mic, sweating bullets, because that's what he just did, shaking on the couch just to post it there. But cutting back in... With this movie coming out, like I said earlier, and this is kind of the point of contention, is I think it's set up to be the first live-action anime success story.
For sure, because that's the whole Ghost in the Shell debacle.
We're going to touch on that, because that's where I don't see Ghost in the Shell when I see this movie. Do I see a little bit of controversy? Yeah, because you got her. She does kind of look like they're trying to make her look Japanese. But also...
They should.
But also, I look at the cast and who's going to be in this movie. It's very diverse. I think that's huge. Mm-hmm. And I think if this movie is able to be successful, then maybe I'll give it 3 years, we could get an Akira movie.
Oh, yes. Boy.
Because, I mean, if we're going to even poke at Ghost in the Shell, and they failed to me, that was terrible. Scarlet. And if this movie is great...
That's not the reason it was terrible.
No,
there's multiple reasons. There's multiple reasons. There's multiple issues wrong with Ghost in the Shell. This movie does have potential to be great. I think if this movie is great at the box office, holds well, especially when it goes, you know, overseas, I can see an Akira movie being made.
Well, and we have to give it to James Cameron then.
Yeah.
I don't see anybody else, because that's the
he's
or
the one
somebody
doing this
with
movie.
The same. Yeah, that's exactly why.
It's like him, Robert Rodriguez, and John Landau. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Big names too, guys.
Really big, very well produced on this one, as well as directed, and I mean, you need somebody with crazy vision of, like, you know what, I know the technology doesn't exist to make this look the way I want it to. We're gonna have to work on that.
Yes.
It's what he did for Titanic. It's what he did for Avatar. My goodness, like, the entirety of that movie was shot on proprietary technology almost.
I feel like with Avatar,
that's an exaggeration.
I feel like with Avatar actually came out right before the superhero boom. And I think that's one of the things that really helped push Avatar.
It was the year after Iron Man, but it was right before they started to
the big
push
boom.
That,
yes,
right before they started the Avengers initiative.
And I'll tell you exactly why Avatar was the turning point for CGI.
Yes, totally
100%. I was having this discussion with somebody else about the Lord of the Rings series and how I was so upset with The Hobbit for what they did, and very specifically why. Other nerds on J.R.R. Tolkien, I'm actually not going to be talking about the book-to-movie translation, which has its own very large issues with The Hobbit trilogy. I'm talking about what Guillermo del Toro decided to do when he was shooting in the most beautiful country on Earth and airbrush the scenery to make it more vivid. And I'm sitting here like, why? And then we think about how much of the movie, The Lord of the Rings, it gets hailed for how big the budget was. But they didn't use any CGI hardly in that movie, and you can see when they do.
Yeah, it was pretty evident. I mean, I'd say the clear cases of it were when they brought in the dead army and things like Smaug, of course, but across the board, it wasn't like consistent CGI throughout.
I'm talking Core Loader, not Hobbit Trilogy. So, Fellowship, Two Towers, Return of the King.
Right.
So with that one, that trilogy is nuts. And you can also see it when you watch the Harry Potter movies. In the fourth movie and the fifth movie, there's a massive, drastic change in how they animate and how they draw and what they choose to do in costume and what they choose to CGI.
Wow.
And Avatar was one of the catalysts in there, just like The Matrix was for digitization, for creative cinematography, for the 360-degree shot. You know, these two movies had massive turning points in American cinema, and I think James Cameron is set to hit another one, because Titanic was another one. Yeah. There hadn't really been a successful 3.5-hour movie before.
Ever.
And that's the other thing.
That was James Cameron?
That was James Cameron, mm-hmm. Definitely. Oh, yeah, James Cameron, he's like still, what, number one at the box office?
Easy.
Yeah, he's still number one.
I did not like Titanic.
Yeah, he has like three movies that are like...
in the vast minority.
Yeah, I know.
Have you never seen Titanic?
I didn't say I'd never seen it. I said I didn't care for it.
Oh!
It didn't necessarily do that for me, because I guess I knew what was going to happen already.
Right, right.
And it was just, I felt like... they made it more so about the love story than the
Absolutely.
Actual event itself.
Yeah.
Well, that's because, and James Cameron wanted to bring a historical event that was reduced to numbers and the cold hard facts of knowing what happens of history back to the horrible tragedy of the first, one of the big modern, massive tragic accidents, you know, of something like a massive death event. As opposed to like a massacre or something that was involved with the war. This had nothing to do with war. It just was like, crap. Thousands of people died.
And I think that we really felt that with, number one, how long the movie was. And then also that the ship then just hit an iceberg and sink.
Yeah.
We had to watch slowly as people panicked, as the panic set in, as the realization that some people are going to die. Mm-hmm. I think the saddest part to me, sorry guys if you haven't seen Titanic, but is with the mother telling the story to her kids as their ship is sinking because they're not going to make it out.
Yeah.
That was sad.
The saddest part to me was that like string quintet.
And they start playing.
It's been an honor, gentlemen.
Yeah.
To play with you. I was like, God.
Yeah, man, there's so many parts of that movie that can just get you. So if he's able to do that in this movie?
Well, that's what James Cameron always does. And I'm like, don't tell me you didn't anthropomorphize, or like completely humanize every facet of the planet of Pandora.
Yeah.
Oh, definitely.
That movie went straight to your heart.
Beautiful.
And that's what he does.
It was a 21st century Pocahontas to me, but with
Absolutely.
So much more to it.
Like, that's what it's supposed
to be. That's what it is,
yeah.
I think the part I got chills at when it comes to Avatar was when the whole planet came to their defense.
Ooh.
It's beautiful. I got chills. I'm like, ooh!
They got every tribe across the planet involved, and that was what stuck out and was so special to me.
Mm-hmm. And so with Alita, you know, and this bombastic trio of people at the helm, I don't see this going poorly. We see somebody who's going to be utilizing mocap in a very, very new way, and a very creative way. We're going to be seeing an extremely expansive world built, because that's what James Cameron always does. The thing about this one, it's going to be created by him on the same scale as Pandora, but with a little bit more realism because it is on this planet.
Right.
And so what we also see, we mentioned the diversity earlier, is we're going to see that, like, you know, even in dystopia, the real dividers come into play because it is the obscene wealth versus the obscene poverty.
Yes.
And they live on separate, they literally live on separate levels. The rich are in this floating city, which is in every single trailer.
Zalem.
Yep, if they keep the name.
They might if they not, keep the name. And my pronunciation might also be off, but based on how it looks, I would say Zalem.
So then what do you think that, I mean, you probably know what she's fighting for. What is she fighting for? I get it, it's like she's trying to discover who she is, mm-hmm. but then it's also like, where are we going with this? Are we trying to fight for the poor? Are we trying to fight corruption?
I think this is going to be...
Like, what is this?
This is a question of AI.
Definitely.
Okay. Because all of these folks from the trailer that we see that are automatons
right.
are these living bionic weapons, mm-hmm. right? And so... But they're given human appearance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So are they really human? Are they...
They are cyborgs.
Weapons? Are they... you know, is this going to be this classic definition of human movie? And what unites us and what joins us together. And I'm super excited to see James Cameron tell another one of these stories and bring a lot of emotion to the table.
Yeah. He's pretty good at love stories.
He really
gotta
is.
Give it to James Cameron. He's pretty good at love stories.
The human spine yeah. will be very important in this story. That's mm-hmm. not necessarily a spoiler, but the value of like spinal fluid. My bad. Mm-hmm. For not only the cybernetic creatures that you see, mm-hmm. but also the humans, and then like the currency, kind of in a way. Like mm-hmm. it's of course in a post-apocalyptic setting, so things that are valued in that era will be so different than what we see today. So
what resources? So resources
exactly.
are
resources
much different.
And okay. necessities are completely flip-flop than what you would be deemed as important in this era and what we see as value today.
It's going to be fascinating. It's going to be so cool to see all these different things come together to create what I think is going to be just one hell of a story. So that's the hype video. Next Friday, y'all. February 14th. It's February 14th. February.
February. I'm
sorry. Fucking axe cop through the mustache. February. Walk the wrong guy. And that's the way the cookie crumbles.
I'm sorry. Keep going.
So that's the hype video, folks. February 14th, next Friday. Go see this movie in the theaters all weekend. Let's get and see if we can't get Mr. Cameron another record-breaking release.
Oh, yeah.
Till then, check me out on Talking with Teach, this station right here in my playlist. We got Daz the Hero.
Yeah, be on the lookout for the Book of Daz. That will be the stream series that I will be coming out with very shortly. But until then, you know the lotus always blooms twice.
And we got Fame. Check him out on his playlist.
You guys can always find me at Don't Make Me Famous on the Ridge Streamcast YouTube page. follow us on Instagram also. Me and Teach are both still working on our Instagrams.
Currently. I don't want to do it. I'm dragging my feet intentionally.
It's coming though.
Yeah, it'll be there. But we're just out here to spread some knowledge and learn something in return. Have a great day.
And you know the Lotus always brooms three times.
No, three times!